Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Devashri Dattare, Assistant Professor in Comparative Literature at Jadavpur University, Kolkata. Today we shall talk about the subject English. Our paper title is Canadian, Australian and South Pacific Literature. The module that I will be speaking about is Australian short stories by writers of European descent. Certain keywords that we will deal with are European literature, European-Australian short stories, bush realism sketches, bulletin debate, surrealism. In this module, we shall discuss a general introduction on the short stories written by Australian writers of European descent. Biographies of six Australian writers of European descent: Marcus Clark, Henry Lawson, William Astley, Christina Stead, Thelma Forshaw, Michael Wilding. These are the authors that we would focus on. We will also deal with summaries of six short stories by these writers respectively, An Upcountry Township, The Crime of Convict Cuncliffe, The Drover's Wife, The Guest of Red Shields, On Our Safari, The Man of Slow Feeling. The genre of short story has played a pivotal role in shaping and defining the national and cultural identity, that is, the Australianness of the European Australian settlers since the latter half of the 19th century. This is a general introduction that we are trying to give. Much of this has to do with what Karen Goldsworthy calls in his introduction to the anthology titled Australian Short Stories, the three roughly identifiable short story booms in Australia. The first period began with the publication of the Bulletin magazine in the 1880s-90s and the early 1900s, which indeed led to induced descriptive sketches of early urban and rural settlements penned by writers like Marcus Clark to give way to more structured stories with a proper plot. William Astley's stories were based on the convict period, a fundamental aspect of early Euro-Australian settlement. Henry Lawson and Barbara Bainton, the other two writers, were notable of this period, and their stories focus on the hardship faced by the early settlers in the Australian bush. The second period of short story boom came a few decades after the Federation of the Australian Colonies in 1901 in the 1940s. With the end of World War II and the beginning of the publication of the anthology series Coast to Coast, emerged socialist realist writers like John Morrison, Gavin Cassie and Dal Stevens, who consciously moved away from the Lawsonian bush realism. Australian identity began to be defined in relation to and generally in contrast to non-Australian characters or settings by writers like Thelma Forshaw, Elizabeth Joly and Hal Porter. Writers like Frank Davison, Alan Marshall started forging a new Australianness by focusing on personal dilemmas, social problems and urban existence of individuals. The 1970s was marked by the government's support for the arts and the lifting of censorship regulations on one hand and the beginning of the publication of the short story magazine Tabloid Story. These developments induced a generation of writers like Frank Moorhouse, Michael Wilding, Peter Carey and Murray Bale to move away from the realist stories of the 40s and the 50s. They began experimenting with themes of fantasy, sexuality and surrealism in their works, leading to a different sense of Australian literature. They also introduced innovations within the structure of the short story itself, leading to genre transformations. The first story writer that we talk about is Marcus Clark, born in 1846 and died in 1881. He was born in London of English parents and emigrated to Australia at the age of 17. He worked as a journalist and also published several short stories and novels. He is best known for the classic convict novel entitled For the Term of His Natural Life. It is one of the earliest books brought out by an Australian writer of European descent, and he mastered the art of writing a sketch, a form of short story which was later enriched further by Henry Lawson. An upcountry township describes Bullock Town, a township located in the bank of the Polywork Creek of the Great Glimmera. The first-person narrator sprinkles the sketch with local myths and funny anecdotes on some of its prominent residents. The light, informal, often conversational tone is replete with suggestiveness, often hinting at much more than what is said. Before that, we should also have an understanding of what is a sketch. A sketch is a subgenre of short story that was invented in the 16th century in England as a result of increasing public interest in realistic depictions of exotic locales, an urge to appreciate the natural beauty of the new country and to uphold the endeavors of the early European settlers to turn it into their home, resulted in an extensive composition and publication of sketches in mid-late 19th century Australia. This is also true of another country such as Canada. An upcountry township describes Bullock Town, which is, as we know, it is a typical sketch, but it has no discernible plot, located in the Great Glimmera. Though the first-person narrator claims to be an impartial observer, enough indications are there to suggest that he is one of its residents too. Therefore, interestingly, his personal opinions and experiences often seem to color his impartial descriptions. In fact, the sketch is replete with suggestiveness, the narrator hinting at much more than what he says. Not only does he describe the church, the three public houses, the schoolhouse, and the post office of the township, he also goes on to sprinkle the sketch and local myths and funny anecdotes on some of its prominent residents. This is very interesting because this is how one gets an idea of what a sketch paints to do. It paints a people, it paints a community, it paints their sense of feeling, sense of belonging, and from that we get a sense of home and belongingness. One is able to articulate through the economy of the sketch an entire civilization at work. He admits, the storyteller, that some of these anecdotes are rumors, but he himself is part of them, which he authenticates as his truth claim, as happens in the case of the story about Mr. Longlove's friendship with the Duke of Wellington. Please note the hankering towards the Duke of Wellington, towards the mother nation. The light, informed, often conversational tone of the narrator is meant to engage the reader's interest and facilitate his understanding about Bucklertown and its people. It becomes almost colloquial in its tone, and therefore it is more engaging in terms of your understanding of a country and its space. William Astley, who wrote under the pseudonym Price Warung, is the next author that we talk about. He was a journalist and one of the most famous early short story writers of Australia. Born in Liverpool, London, he migrated to Australia with his family at the age of 4 and hereafter resided in Richmond near Melbourne. He became the editor of the Richmond Herald at a very young age and was associated with many other such prestigious journals of Australia. During the 1880s and 1890s, Astley did some freelance work for the Bulletin, in which numerous series of his stories of the convict days, tales of the convict system, tales of the early days, tales of the old regime, tales of the Isle of Death, and half-crown Bob, and tales of the River Ine were published. His stories reveal a sound knowledge of the early history of Australia and a love for humanity. The Crime of Convict Cunliffe deals with one of the most pertinent themes of the 19th century Australian literature, that of the struggle of survival of the nearly 162,000 convicts who were transported from various Australian penal colonies by the British government between 1788 to 1868. The protagonist of the story, convict Cunliffe, is punished severely for a crime of not displaying a meek subordinate attitude towards his tormentors. The supervisors of the tramway team in Norfolk Island, Tin, which he works as a convict, where he works as a convict laborer. The story poses Cunliffe's plea for help as a factor that set the ball rolling for the historical moment when the Roman Catholic Bishop Robert Wilson pledged to advocate the cause of the convicts, thereby endowing the entire tale with a historical significance. Australian poet and writer Henry Lawson is the next person under focus. He was born and raised in a town on the Grenfell Goldfields in New South Wales. He lost his hearing due to an ear infection at the age of 14. One of the most important members of the Bulletin School, he is often hailed as Australia's greatest short story writer. An inland trekking trip into the drought-affected areas of New South Wales that he undertook in 1892 made him aware of the harsh realities of the Australian outback, which became the theme of his poetry and short stories. His most successful prose collection, Wild the Billy Balls, is credited to have reinvented Australian realism. Lawson was a firm believer in the merits of the sketch story. His On the Edge of a Plane is considered to be the most accomplished example of the sketch. This is one of the most fascinating of tales, and it is regarded as one of Lawson's masterpieces. As you know, he was instrumental in constructing an Australian identity, which was based on what is often called a bush-centered masculinist ethos. As we will discuss later, this ethos was bypassed at a later point, and therefore there were other post-Lawsonian identities vis-a-vis the genre. But the Drover's Wife is in many ways an interesting outcome of Lawsonian ethics and aesthetics. It is from the collection which was published in 1901, The Country I Come From. The story is an exception in the sense that it moves away from the usual themes of mateship and notoriety of the bushhangers and concerns itself with the female experience of the Australian bush. This is very interesting because it has been in most cases a male-centric perspective, but over here one is moving away from it. It portrays the struggle of the survival of a bushwoman living miles away from civilization, striving to protect her children from a poisonous snake. One is reminded in this case of Canada and the journals of Susanna Moody, which also spoke of such perspectives and how roughing it in the bush it was called. The hardships almost emasculate her, depriving her of the typical womanly qualities. Yet she enjoys this life, taking every challenge in a stride and making the most of every opportunity that comes her way. Like many of his other works, it is an ideal example of how Lawson strove to counter the romantic, idyllic vision of the Australian as a bush reflected. Australian as a bush person reflected in the works of the contemporary poet Banjo Paterson, a tendency which gave rise to the famous Bulletin debate. It also embodies some of his typical narrative strategies, including the use of local languages, the tendency to move back and forth in time, and the gradual culmination of the story into a dramatic climax. So even genrically and thematically, it marks a significant departure from Australian short stories that came before. The Drover's Wife is an iconic presentation of Australian identity and Australian sense of belonging at that point of time. It marks our sense of what Australian literature was striving to be, to create a niche of its own, which was away from whatever was before. Christina Stead is the next writer that we talk about. Australianist novelist and short story writer Christina Stead was born in Sydney suburb of Rochdale, New South Wales. Though she had lived abroad for many years, her literary works are essentially Australian in content. Although contemporary with social realists, she was never one of them. She was a writer much ahead of her times. Her novel, The Man Who Loved Children, is considered by many as her masterpiece. The collection of her stories include The Salzburg Tales, 1934, The Puzzle Head Girl, Four Novellas, 1965, An Ocean of Story, The Uncollected Stories of Christina Stead, edited by R.G. Gearing, 1985. Guest of the Red Shields is one of the many stories that constitute Stead's first literary work, The Salzburg Tales, published in 1934. It is constructed along the lines of the entire collection of stories is constructed along the lines of Decameron. A large number of tales and by different characters are loosely held together by an overarching narrative continuity. The Castle of Red Shields, where the protagonist is invited for a party, is a utopia, and it spells ultimate luxury right in it. It is representative of an economic prosperity that the protagonist of the story, a poet deep in debt who represents the common man in the clutches of depression, can only dream of. Stead addresses the social concerns of contemporary Australia by highlighting the mental and physical deprivation that befell Australia during the years of depression through the use of elements of fantasy and her deeply psychological characterization. The next author is Thelma Forshaw. Australian journalist and short story writer Thelma Forshaw was born in Globe Point, a suburb in Sydney. During World War II, Forshaw enlisted in the WAAF, from where she was honorably discharged as an aircraft woman. She worked as a secretary and advertising writer before she started working as a freelance writer and book reviewer for journals like the Sydney Morning Herald, The Age, The Australian, The Bulletin, Mianjin Nation and Quadrant. In 1967, she wrote a collection of autobiographical short stories, An Affair of Clowns, which is considered to be her greatest literary achievement. Thelma Forshaw belonged to the group of short story writers who tackled the increasingly difficult task of defining a national culture and identity in the post-World War II Australia by comparing and contrasting the same with the culture of identity alien to it. An influx of European immigrants in Australia during the war years created the perfect ambience. This is the kind of juxtaposition that On Our Safari enables. On Our Safari is one such story which portrays how the arrival of a family of German immigrants in a poultry farming Australian suburb forged among its residents, especially a hospitable couple next door, a renewed awareness of what being Australian might or might not mean. Forshaw strives to direct some light but double-handed, irony at her fellow Australians. This smug sense of superiority over people hailing from a culture different from that of their own, the crux of their sense of identity as Australians, forms the sense of identity that Forshaw is so interested in. She shows us that this very difference ensures a greater professional success for the couple from Vienna and for the family instead of the neighbors from Australia. Michael Wilding is the next author that we talk about. He was born in Worcester in 1942. He came to Australia after graduating from Oxford, widely known as a reviewer, critic, publisher, and a colorful academic figure. He was a professor of English and Australian literature in the University of Sydney. Along with novels and plays, he has published several collections of short stories, some of the most famous of them being Aspects of the Dying Process, published in 1972, and The Man of Slow Feeling, Selected Short Stories, 1985. He belonged to the generation of writers, others being Frank Moorhouse, Peter Carey, and Murray Hill, who began to experiment with the theme and the genre of the short story in the 70s, marking a departure from the predominantly well-structured realist stories being written in the mid-20th century Australia. The Man of Slow Feeling is a story from the selection, The Man of Slow Feeling, Selected Short Stories, published in 1985, is one of the many stories of Wilding in which he has explored the scope of a surrealistic approach towards life. The removal of censorship regulations in the 70s Australia has allowed him to openly explore the theme of sexuality as well. The protagonist of the story, who has survived the almost fatal accident, thinks that he has lost his ability to feel the sensations that are supposed to arise not out of his daily experiences, till he realizes that sensations are not denied to him but have been delayed by precisely 3 hours. The agony of being controlled by his past experiences finally drives him to commit suicide. The story also highlights the importance of the coordination of any tangible experience with its resultant sensation. Therefore, while we have discussed the short story writers, we have tried to project a sense of Australianness, a sense of identity that emerged from it, that emerged from beyond the bush reality of the region, that emerged and tried to think of beyond being part of a mother nation. We have discussed the changing counters of the short story writing in Australia by the writers of European descent. We have looked into the genre of the short story itself and the possibilities that the genre offers us in different perspectives. We have explored the important role played by the genre in shaping and defining the national and cultural identity and forging a sense of what being Australian is all about. We have been able to engage with the sense of Australian history in the world of letters and in the world of social material realities, and we have also analyzed the formal innovations of the stories that we are talking about. We hope that this discussion would enable us to have a greater understanding of the Australian short story, especially in its early years, until how it emerges as an important genre of expression in a country which was emerging slowly to a different sense of aesthetic responsibility and understanding.